plenty of time for questions and comments. I mean, as I was presented, I'm from the PCS Union, Public and Commercial Services. This is a union that represents about 100,000 civil servants, or in private companies that have got civil service contracts that include the Scottish government. The PCS Culture Group, which I am the president of, represents museum workers across the country, including in Scotland. So National Museums of Scotland, the National Gallery, Historic Scotland, Visit Scotland are all part of our group. And I think let's be very clear that we've heard about how migrant people are being blamed, or China being blamed for the climate crisis. But it is actually caused by a system of accumulation of capital that is possible only by the unlimited extraction and exploitation of natural resources, human beings and animals, and that's capitalism. It is the story of inequality, the poor versus the rich, the global north versus the south, but actually we need to work together to fight that system. And I think that I really welcome the action of youth strikers and also Extinction Rebellions that in the last 12 months have progressed the emergency, the nature of the climate crisis to a level we haven't seen up to now. You know, I've been campaigning for 10 years in the trade union movement to bring those issues to the front, and we've now got more hope that people are coming on board. So the trade union movement need to be supporting those young people and people taking direct action more than ever before. My work members across the sector have been taking such action. So in the Liverpool Museum where I work, on the 20th of September, we had a group of about 30 workers that came out during their lunchtime to support the climate strikers. But also in the museums, we put on public-facing activities about extinction of species, about plastic. It was our archaeology team that did an activity on plastic. So we were like on both fronts, you know, like educational people, but also the direct solidarity. In London, museum workers have linked up with other art workers to build a block of art workers versus climate. They started demonstrating at the National Theatre, that was sponsored by Shell. Move on to the South Bank Centre, also sponsored by Shell. Move on to the Tate, that used to be sponsored by BP before they joined, you know, some of our climate strikers on the day. It is a very difficult time. You know, people are increasingly suffering with their mental health because it's such a difficult situation that we've got very little hope, we're not sure how to solve it. And we see a development of collapse theories. I'm not going to go on about collapse theories, although, you know, climate change is already happening. This is the reality that we have got to face, and we need to almost have a bereavement of this is happening. We've seen the floods in the UK, the fires in Australia, in California, you know, the droughts in a number of areas. The rainy season in some African countries is becoming shorter. So this is a very fragile system, but we need hope and we need solutions, because what we know is the options that is not on the table is do nothing. So bringing the trade union movement on board has been very tricky, because for years the portrayal of the fight against climate change has been it's going to delay jobs, it's going to go back to the Stone Age, etc. I mean, we have Unite supporting East Rome. GMB signed a deal with the fracking lobby a few years ago. I mean, now it's been altered temporarily by the Tory government as an electoral tactic. But Prospect support nuclear. And generally, the trade union Congress policy is to have a balanced energy mix. And the balanced energy mix is about space for nuclear, space for gas. We have to reverse that. We have to get into our trade union to change those policies and to, you know, really like democratically change those policies to put an end to that. And that's where, if you're in a trade union, you can become a green rat. And, you know, act in the workplace to raise awareness, but also push motions inside your unions to support the initiative. A number of unions are already doing that. The Bakers Union recently are using their health and safety rep to start tackling environmental issues, looking at air pollution, but also working conditions, in those food factories where often the heat is affecting workers, but it's also being lost and we could reuse it. So there's a lot of issues that trade union could embrace and actually get their members on board by linking up the climate, the terms and conditions, the working conditions together. That's where the climate jobs come in. And the climate jobs, I'm really proud to say that my union was a founding member of the climate jobs with the UCU and a few other unions and the campaign against climate change. The first edition was 2008, folks. No, it was 11 years ago, and we haven't moved forward. We've actually, the third edition, and you've got copies there available, I encourage you to read it, but that was 2014, 5 years ago. It took inspiration of the work done by the Lucas aerospace workers that were looking at refusing to work producing arms and instead producing socially useful goods. So the inspiration came from that, but looking more at the climate angle. What is a climate job? I'm going to be quite quick on that because I could like go on forever, but I've got a few more things that I'd like to squeeze in. So a climate job reduces CO2 emissions directly. It's mainly CO2, although we'll see that the pamphlet talks about other, you know, like warming gas, like methane, etc. But it's mainly CO2 that we need to target. So it's, for example, producing, installing, maintaining wind turbine, working in recycling of waste, building electric vehicles, or insulating housing, or teaching new skills to be able to do so. A climate job is also a public job, not private sector. It needs to have good pay, terms and conditions, it needs to be unionized, and need to be directly employed, not via procurement and contractor, because when profit-making is involved, you know, we're not going in the right direction, it's not going to be efficient enough, and we need to move away from that logic. So it can, the 1 million climate job can help reduce unemployment, provide alternative jobs for those workers in polluting industry or the energy sector, can improve people's life and tackle the climate crisis at the same time. We pay for it by public investments, income from increased tax on corporations and the rich, revenues from the bills that those services will still deliver to customers. Those who can afford it will pay for it, so there will be income that way. Closing tax loopholes and tax evasion. I mean, you know all the arguments that are put forward in other sectors on how we can finance it. The details of the costing are in the booklet. We could create 1 million climate jobs over the course of 10 years and reduce emissions in this country by 80%. Unfortunately, this was 2009-2014. So the likeliness is we need to do it faster and quicker, and we have about 10 years to do so. In terms of numbers, the research established that we could create 400,000 jobs in electricity production via renewables. So that's the production of the goods, the installation, the maintenance in wind, solar, and tidal. There are issues of those raw materials that will need to be used for this, and I think that's a reflection that has been growing in the last 5 years that may not be included into the pamphlet as much. But a comment before was saying about how we can reuse the steel from oil rigs to produce those wind turbines. You know, there are a lot of materials that are already in the system that we could go and get where we don't need them to reuse them for socially more useful productions. In terms of transport, we are talking about 310,000 jobs in the electrification, the production of vehicles, drivers, support staff, etc. It's not about replacing every single individual car, petrol diesel car, by everybody who will have their own electric car, because that wouldn't be possible. We need to concentrate on public transport, and the priority should be about electrifying those networks. The train, I mean, we still got diesel train in this country, this is absolutely madness. 185,000 jobs in the building and construction industry with insulation of housing, street by street, public building insulation, and also building new housing. Sustainable social housing or cheap housing for people, because we've got massive housing crisis in this country. So we could tackle those, as well as fuel poverty and You know, there'll be a workshop as well on fuel poverty and housing, so make sure you think about the jobs that could be created around that as well as tackling poverty. Without going into details, there is also other area where jobs could be created, like in industry and the decarbonization of a certain industry. 35,000 in education to reskill people or create new skills. 45,000 in agriculture, waste and forestry. But the key with that concept of climate job, it can be adapted to different situations, different countries, different areas, depending on the nature of the economy, the nature of the needs of local people. And we've seen the climate job campaign going global in the last 7 years. We've had campaigns producing strategies in South Africa, in Norway, in Portugal, in France, in New York. I actually got like the French have done it in a very like nice little format like this. But also, also this strategy could be declined at local level. And the Basque country, for example, have produced a pamphlet that looked at producing, I think it was 10,000 climate jobs for the Basque country. PCS, we also worked with the anti-fracking campaigners in Blackpool and the Fylde to look at how we could create 4,500 jobs instead of fracking jobs in that area. And that was a very important argument to oppose fracking and the false claim we had about the number of jobs it could create. So the climate jobs are a tool in this campaign that you can use. And you know, I said that developing a climate job strategy for Scotland is something that a number of organizations have started to do, but actually be quite good to bring together those initiatives to have a very strong demand and a very strong strategy that we can take to the school strikers, that we can take to the authority, to the local governments, to the Scottish Parliament. Summer, please. I've got 8 minutes left, but okay, I'll be quicker than that. Just transition is similar to what we're talking about, but it's about making sure that the poor are not paying for resolving the crisis, that energy workers in productive industry are not paying the price of the transition. Those jobs could help that just transition. PCS has also produced like a longer strategy about just transition in the civil service that's all available on our websites. You've got a lot of trade unions looking at energy democracy, and I've just briefly mentioned the Trade Union for Energy Democracy, which has got fantastic research. They were in the last week or so, looking at what's happening in Chile and how trade unions are linking up with civil society and environmental organization, the crisis that's happening. The 1 million climate jobs have also influenced the Labour Party and their Green Industrial Revolution strategies that is now being touring the country. Ideas are being also replicated in the Green New Deal, and I think there may be a speaker later about that. But ultimately, we need to link to bread and butter issues, because that's what people understand. Because when you can't eat, when you can't warm yourself, when you haven't got a job, when you are homeless, you can talk about going and occupying and do campaign, but it's very difficult. So, linking to fuel poverty and housing, to the pension, to the air pollution that's affecting children and actually reducing the size of their lungs at the moment are really absolutely crucial to keep people on board. So I thought I had 6 minutes, and that was going to be.
I think you do. I think it's my mistake.
Okay, but I will try to be less than 6 minutes to make sure we've got time for question debates. But I just wanted to tell you a bit something that's a bit closer to my heart, which is about museum galleries. We've seen an increase, of the austerity cuts in all these arts and cultures. That is actually something that makes us human, and that we need to uphold and to keep going. We're seeing a commercialization of this sector that is absolutely outrageous. And part of this is that we are looking at increasing commercial income for museums instead of having public investment into them. As a result, we're seeing fossil fuel companies sponsoring many of our art and museums galleries. Started to come to a real link with our strategy in 2015. Where my union was running a campaign against the privatization of the National Gallery
400 workers were ultimately privatized. We failed to stop this privatization. But we started to realize that it was sponsored by Shell, and National Gallery had actually opened this temporary exhibition that was sponsored by Shell while we were on strike, and using staff labels. So we were suspicious that Shell's money had helped to pay for those workers. That's where we started to link up with an organization called Arnold Oil that was campaigning against the oil sponsorship in Arts and Gallery. Similarly, at the Tate, it was sponsored by BP, where we were having zero arts contracts. Not surprisingly, at the time, the chair of trustees was a guy called Lord Brown, former CEO of BP, and also was the CEO of Quadrilla, the fracking company. This was the guy who was like deciding about this oil sponsorship. In the British Museum, absolute scandal, a place sponsored by BP again, where our members in the culture sector were working for Carrion as cleaners and porters, and when Carrion collapsed, those people were treated absolutely disgusting, where the management refused to talk to them, to talk to their unions, for 4 months, they didn't know what was going to happen, and then they were transferred to a private company, and those are private companies, on 3 months contract, people had been working there for 20, 30 years. During that time, they were holding little ceremonies with, champagne and canapés with the executive of BP, the sponsor, as well as many embassies from foreign governments. So for example, BP sponsored Day of the Dead event, Day of the Dead event, which is a traditional celebration in Mexico. So they were able to mix up with the ambassador of Mexico just when BP was bidding for oil field in Mexico. They sponsored an exhibition of stolen artifacts from Aboriginal community in Australia just at the time they were bidding for oil field in Australia. They sponsored an exhibition about Assyrian artwork, Iraq, just at the time BP is trying to get oil field in Iraq. And every single time, they get to meet all those politicians in the comfort of our workplace, of our museum, absolutely outrageous. In Scotland, we had some good news in the last few years. I mean, Edinburgh Festival dropped BP. We were told BP dropped the Edinburgh Festival, but, you know. I've read that Edinburgh Festival has now banned oil sponsorship for the rest of the future. We've also seen the National Galleries of Scotland that were hosting the BP Portrait Award have now said they will not host it if it's still sponsored by BP. So we're making inroads, and what we need is to reclaim the power, because those people in power are the ones who are stopping change, are stopping the transitions, and are making our life a misery. I won't tell the story of Jim Ratcliffe, which I usually tell in my conclusion, because although I've got 1 minute and 45 seconds, I'll tell you the story of Jim Ratcliffe, sorry, because I promised to somebody else. So Jim used to be the richest man in the country last year. He's now dropped a few, I think he's fourth now or something. He actually owned the biggest chemical plant in the UK, not far from where I live, in a place called Runcorn, that got a lot of industry there, had very high rates of cancer and respiratory diseases, with people like who are like quite poor. The cost of energy to produce chemical is really high. So he had this brilliant idea. He decided to produce his own energy. What type? Waste incineration. He built his own waste incinerator, got a contract from Greater Manchester local authorities. All the waste from Greater Manchester is coming, often by lorries, to Runcorn to be built in this waste incinerator, creating air pollution, creating toxic waste, but also creating free energy for Jim. He's a very clever guy. So he's building all our waste, making free energy to produce his chemicals, polluting the area of Runcorn. And it's the same Jim who in Grange Mouse had a dispute with Unite oil refinery, and also he wanted to do some fracking there. It's all one circle, and people like Jim need to be brought down, and only us can do it. Solidarity.